see black and white in a world full of hate. Be a light.
All right, and welcome to our second episode of Brotherly Love Presents Unite. And today, the guest on our show, Maven Bentley, the president of CZW and the manager of one of the best tag teams in independent wrestling, The Rep.
Maven, everybody. Welcome. Thank you. Appreciate it.
So basically, what we want to do is, I mean, we have a perspective, but we don't have an informed or a firsthand perspective, so to speak. Mm-hmm. So we want to get your outlook being a black man in America and then kind of transition it to into the wrestling world as well. So what it's like, what it feels like, because we can only, not even firsthand, we can only tell secondhand of what we see. We can't say how we feel. We can say how we feel, but it hasn't become as personal, if that makes sense.
That makes sense. So where do you want to start? Being a black man in America is a long, difficult life.
It is, and it's hard to say right now because everything's coming to light currently. I mean, it's been like this for
forever.
So now, unfortunately, someone had to die, and it get a million different views all over social media and the news and whatnot, and now people are starting to be in the know. They're starting to see it, and they're starting to become uncomfortable and angry and sympathetic, and then there's another side that's the exact opposite of that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I mean, so from my two cents, I'm a natural pessimist, to be honest with you. And the sad fact of the matter to me is I don't think a damn thing's going to change. I think there are going to be riots and protests and all kinds of horrible stuff. And then, you know, 2 months from now, we'll go back to watching 90 Day Fiancé or whatever the fucking craze is at the time. And, you know, some cop will kill another black person, or, you know, a civilian will kill a black person. We're calling him a nigger on shooting one spring blank range with a shotgun. Someone will videotape it. They'll laugh about it. And no one will get prosecuted again. You said something that's interesting. You're saying, you know, now millions of people are seeing it and are becoming uncomfortable and scared and other things of that nature. This was the same case in 92 with Rodney King. I remember there being this thought in the black community. And mind you, I will preface everything with saying that, you know, I think the justice system has a problem. I think there are great individual police officers walking the street, you know, because obviously, you know, it's not every cop is an asshole, but the system is messed up. And unfortunately, every cop works for a messed up system. So whether he or she is a good person, the system is corrupt. But, you know, black America was really saying this has been a problem since the end of slavery, you know, police abusing people of color and not being held accountable for it. And when Rodney King happened, you know, we as black America all stopped and said, finally, it's on tape. Now they know we're going to be good. And then we watched the officers get acquitted. And we kind of knew then and there that, you know, it's going to be the same old business as usual. I'm scared this will be business as usual. You know, since you guys brought it up, you know, when you think about Black Lives Matter, that hashtag and the organization, which is really just three black women, by the way. It's not a big organization for everyone thinks. It's three women, three sisters. And, you know, they provide very sparse stuff to people who want to try to do chapters in different cities. But it's really just three people. Well, let me rephrase. It's bigger now, but start with three people, and it's a very small organization, really. You know, it started with civilians killing black people. Trayvon Martin was the first Black Lives Matter hashtag and movement. And it wasn't because, you know, as some people think, you know, blacks over whites. No, it's simply, we knew this guy was getting off. He literally was told by authorities, don't go after this young man. We'll send police. We'll see what's going on. This young kid's on the phone to his girlfriend saying, I'm scared. Someone's following me. I don't know what's going on. He's got Skittles and iced tea in his hand. You know, this guy goes up and attacks him. The guy can't fight. The kid beats him up. And he shoots the kid and gets off. I mean, to me, it's a remnant of just how not just racist our system is, but stupid. Because, you know, stand your ground, as far as I'm concerned, is the purge. It means I can start a fight with you, lose on purpose, then shoot you with no repercussions. And to me, that is the wrong thing to say to anybody, because, you know, I mean, what's stopping me from you know, people I have heat with, that I can just go, well, I don't like you, and I don't want to go to jail, but if I push you in a town that's, you know, staying your ground, and you hit me harder than I hit you, now I can shoot you. It's just ridiculous. So, you know, the thing you brought up is the idea of uncomfortable, and people are seeing it. People have been seeing it for years. I mean, even with just Black Lives Matter, Trayvon, Sandra Bland, Philando Castile, the dude literally told the cop, yes, I have a weapon, I have a permit. Get your permit. Okay, I'm going to my permit. Got shot in the chest for going for the thing the cop told him to get. Eric Garner, I mean, it's been over and over. We've seen him. So I'm a pessimist. I hope I'm wrong. I hope people, you know, continue to go to the streets and let elected officials know that we will be voting you out if you don't hold a police accountable. And mind you, it's not the police as much as it is the DAs that aren't prosecuting the police, the internal investigations that aren't doing what they're supposed to, and the police unions that protect the police when they're doing wrong. I have no problem with unions. I don't want people to think I'm anti-union. I am not. But I am anti-union that protects people doing wrong. And that, to me, is the problem, is that the system protects, you know, the bad apples. And if I can paraphrase Chris Rock before you ask me a question about wrestling, you know, there are some jobs where you can't have bad apples. You never hear American Airlines saying, we're sorry for our bad apple pilots. Most of our pilots like to land the plane. We got 3 or 4 that listen to crash in buildings. How the hell do we have bad apple cops? You know, they eat guns. If there's ever a job to weed out a bad apple, that's the job to do it at. And the fact that we don't is ridiculous. And obviously, you know, being a Black man, it's more scary for me. But I, you know, same of anyone else, whether you're white, Black, Asian, whatever nationality, if you're killed by a police officer and that officer is not prosecuted, your family has been done wrong, besides the fact you lost your loved one, now, you know, basically they get to laugh at you and say, yeah, and we'll keep killing you. And, you know, I couldn't imagine. I mean, it's ridiculous. But on to questions. I mean, we can talk about this more if you want.
Yeah, I mean, we'll mix in here or there. We'll try and break up the two sides.
Okay.
But, I mean, to touch on the system and the way that they're taught, I mean, I was a part of that system. I was part of my studies in college, criminal justice and all that. And it wasn't till I got to my final year that I realized that it wasn't for me, because I took a class in ethics and morality. And basically what they're telling you is that you can't have any. You can't have a moral compass. You can't have an ethical conduct about you, because that will be tested daily. When you have to, when they look at you to pull the trigger, and that's basically what it comes down to, is when they look at you to pull the trigger, you have to do it. Yeah. It's either you or them. And that's basically what they're teaching from, and that's not even the academy, that's just in college. And you have all these people that you see, they're like, all right, well, you can tell kind of who this type is going to be. The people that now all of a sudden I have a gun and now I get to be tough. Now I can be tough. Why do you need that to be tough? Why do you need that to, it's like I've moment to where I got the power and I can unleash it on other people. Not even the people that did them wrong or the people that they're mad at, just that, okay, I have to follow the code. This is what has been done for years and years and years, so now I have to abide by this, and this is who they tell me to look at. This is who we're preconditioned to look at. This is imprinted into their brain and rammed into their brain. Now, some people get in, and some people are a part of the change, and some people want and some people won't. But then you get the vast majority of the, because you got to remember the hierarchy, they're older, so they're passing down all of that knowledge and all of that racism and all of that, what's been instilled in their values and their system. They're going to keep passing that down year after year after year to new cadets, and it is scary.
I mean, if you think of it this way, you know, Ruby Bridges, she was the first little Black girl that the National Guard had to escort to school for integration schools in the South. She's in her 60s today. She just qualified for retirement. I think she's 65 or 66. You know, so when you talk about the higher ups, they're still in the job, some of the cases. Or you know, this isn't, people talk about racism like it was, you know, years and years and years, oh, generations ago. And no, these people are still there. And I think what you said about the them or us type attitude of, you know, it's you or me, one of us has to die, that's one of the biggest problems with policing, in my opinion. And again, please don't, I have friends who are officers who are legitimately afraid of their life because they run towards dangerous situations, and I get that. But the problem is if you put this mentality in and someone's going to a traffic stop already scared, you know, most people are scared going to fight or flight mode, right? And if you're a fight guy and you're pulling over someone who's also a fight guy, of course there's going to be a fight. You know, my girlfriend now, she has panic attacks when the police stop. I mean, like you can, she starts hyperventilating. She's always scared that some police officer's going to think she's on drugs and take her in for that because she's like, you know, I'm a black woman. She's also, you know, she's got a thick accent. She's an immigrant. She's an American citizen, but she wasn't born here. And she's like, I've got an accent. I'm black. You know, I don't have a, you know, she doesn't wear long relaxers in her hair. She has natural hair and it's very short. She's like, I'm a prototype against you, Latino guy, me, you know, and she's right. So it's a very scary thought that some officers are being taught that. I was actually having a discussion with some of my buddies. I train in jiu-jitsu. I've done some mixed martial arts and junk like that too. And our school actually offers discounts to police officers because our head coach is a former cop. And he's a big believer in if you can defend yourself with your hands, there's less chance of you pulling out your gun because you'll be less scared. And one, even if, you know, if an officer puts me down and puts me in some kind of a hold and, you know, keeps me on the ground and I'm in pain, I'd rather that happen than be shot. So, you know, then I get my day in court to fight back and say it was excessive or whatever it was or whether it wasn't. Because, but, you know, but if I'm so scared that every time I'm confronting somebody, especially people of color, because you're absolutely right, people are taught that people of color are scary and not even, you know, not even explicitly a lot of times, you know, it's only been recently that you've seen, you know, more black heroes in movies. Usually, you know, you watch the 80s, you know, if you were black in a movie, you were a maid, a butler, or a criminal. You know, that was it. So, you know, it's actually funny. You know, many people in the wrestling community know that Danny Havoc passed on not that long ago. Mm-hmm. And I remember Danny Havoc saying, I think you're the first black guy I ever met in real life. And he met me and Bruce Purcell, another wrestler, wrestled in CZW once as Eradication. You know, met me and him at the wrestling academy, like his first day of coming to train. And we were just sitting outside. And I was like, I think you're the first black person I ever met in real life. So you think about that. If all he ever saw on TV was, you know, black people raping people or robbing people or whatever, what's he supposed to think when he sees me? You know, it's and officers the same way because they're taught, you know, look, these are what criminals look like. And, you know, it's typically someone in black attire, you know. So it is a shame. And I sincerely hope that the unrest that's happening actually brings forth change. And, you know, I know there are some academies doing better jobs. I hope the colleges do better jobs. I hope the DAs, mayors, whoever else does better jobs in saying we can't tolerate bad apples in police force, period. Because it also, on the other side of things, it puts officers in danger. Because, you know, I would say, you know, people talk about racism and judging everyone by their color and how they look. You know, police officers literally all look alike. They dress them in the same exact uniform. They teach
same
them.
Same haircut, same everything. Mm-hmm. Huh? Same haircut and everything.
Yeah, exactly. So it's like, if one officer harassed me the other day or shot my brother or whatever, and you pull up, I'm thinking it's you. And, you know, again, depending on my fight or flight response, if it's a fight response, now the officer's also in more danger. So it's this kind of perpetuating thing of the community is scared of them, they're scared of the community. And again, not all cops, not all community members, but enough that it ends up bad way too many times. And for those police that, you know, and you know, I will say this to the police, you're the ones at work, it is on you to fix it. You know, I know a lot of cops say, well, they're doing this bad stuff. Yeah, but I'm not at work, it's not my job. And I don't mean, you know, I'm not saying, I'm not giving excuses to people who act like assholes. Yeah, you know, I'm saying, you know, when you walk into a Starbucks or some bullshit, and you ask for a latte, they tell you to go fuck yourself. They're the wrong one, even if you're rude asking for the latte, right? They're the one at work. So
it's always right.
Yeah, you know, so my hope is that this will go better than I think. But again, you know, Sandra Bland, Eric Garner, Philando Castile, you know, I can sit here and name for 12 hours black. Hell, go back to Emmett Till, look that away, girl. I killed for that. Looking at a white girl. Too many times the justice system has failed, especially African Americans. And you know, it's I'm not hopeful that it will change. I honestly think that it's just going to get worse. I think that we have you know, leadership. I think the fact that Donald Trump's president shows it's going to get worse. You know, I don't. I'm not trying to shit on anyone's political proclivities, but if you support Donald Trump, fuck you, you're an asshole. And I say that not because, you know, I don't have a problem with fiscal conservatism. I don't have a problem with the old Republican Party of we're trying to look out for people's money. But Donald Trump's platform was fuck people who aren't white and aren't men too, because he grabs women by the pussy and that's okay apparently, which I wish I had known while I was single. Oh, you know. Anyway.
I didn't want to. I don't want to. I mean, yes, the police force is a big problem and a big part of the problem. But now, like you said, you fear that it's getting worse, and it kind of already is, because now you don't have to just worry about the police. Now you have this case just a few days ago, that there was a black man by the name of
Ahmad?
Robert Fuller.
Robert, yeah.
In California, who hung himself in a, I don't know, a public square somewhere, and
that's another one that is found too.
There, yeah, I mean, that's the thing though. I mean, of all the things to commit suicide, and in this time, you really think a black person's going to go that route?
First of all, for most people, I mean, and this is in the age of the internet, right? And I'm not encouraging any of your viewers to do this, but you can Google easiest way to kill yourself with less pain. Hanging is not an easy way to fucking die. It sucks. You live for a long time when you're hanged. You know, because if you don't break your neck instantly and sever your, you know, the brainstem, you know, you're sitting there in pain, choking,
suffocating.
It's not fun. I mean, and again, I don't want to start telling people how to kill themselves, but there are much better ways to do it. So unless there's no other possible way, if you're in some kind of secluded place, you know, like sometimes you see it in jail cells because they can't get any other thing to do. It's not what's happening. It's not. I'd be very shocked if there was some kind of proof that we could say that this person killed themselves by hanging. I mean, hell, we're in America. You need a firearm like that, right? Shoot yourself in the fucking head. Not encouraging that, people. It's a much cleaner way to go. I don't... Hanging is it's in a public place. That's the other thing too.
What has come out that it's in recent years has been more of a stronger populated KKK community.
Yeah, well, you know, Pennsylvania, I believe, still holds the record of, you know, active supremacist groups.
Yeah.
So, you know, like I'm from the Philadelphia area. I went to school out in Lancaster. For old school wrestling fans who remember Half Breed Billy Graham and Cult Fiction, we shot a movie out in Bloomsburg, Pennsylvania. I was with Bruce Purcell, who is a good friend of mine. He's a stand-up comedian now. He used to wrestle with us. And I remember we're driving through these cornfields and shit, and like, we're like, is that a fucking burning cross? Okay, yeah, we're getting the fuck out of here as soon as we can. It's ridiculous to me that people are so poorly educated, and I do look at it as an education issue. That you lack the critical thinking that you would stop and say that because someone's skin color is different than yours, they must be inferior. You know,
it doesn't make sense.
It doesn't. I mean, I'm also a believer of the fact that it is a tool. Racism is a tool to keep people in power, not just against blacks, but also for whites. You know, I mean, that's the old Southern strategy thing. You tell poor white people that they're better than black people and vote for me and I'll keep you better than black people, you still feel you have some pride. Well, at least I'm not a nigger. I mean, and that's literally what people just go around and say. You know, I might be poor, but I'm not black. And that kind of stuff, it still works. I mean, again, that's how Donald Trump won. And to any of your viewers who are Trump fans, you know, I am saying fuck you to you. They're not. I don't know what their political views are. I am. Because I think in this day and age, it's obvious. I mean, a guy who says he's Mexican, he can't possibly be a fair judge to a Mexican-American judge. Really? That's not classic racism. Black person walks into his rally, beat him up, get him out of here.
It's ignorance and it's stupidity at the same time. It really is.
The fact that he said George Floyd would be happy because the job numbers are good.
Yeah.
George Floyd's fucking dead. He's not happy about shit. He's fucking dead. You know, like this guy's... anyway, I mean, I raise my blood pressure talking about Trump.
That's all right. Raise away. I mean, Liar's the only one wearing red. I'm just going to say that.
Sorry. But it's a rep red, so it's okay.
Exactly. Exactly.
That's true.
It's rep red because I want their money to be straight. I always look out for Nate and Dade and Bishop for that matter, too, making sure their money's right. So, you know, I have no problem with fiscal conservatism. I disagree with trickle-down economics and stuff, but if you honestly, I actually think, all right, so I don't particularly think, you know, the two-party system is the best system, but I do think you need dissenting voices. You know, I think it's helpful to have someone say, I see it differently than you. The problem is that in America, we no longer have a Republican and Democratic Party that both agree on facts anymore. You know, they can't agree on where to go. It used to be they both say, we think that kids should be educated well. The Democrats say, well, I think that means more liberal arts and this. The Republicans would say, I think it means more efficiency in the school, but we still agree kids should be educated well.
Yes.
That's a place where we can't agree what science is. You know, y'all take that out of the schools. That's not real science. The fuck it isn't. It's science. Your beliefs don't overcome science. And I don't tell people they can't have their belief systems, but I can tell you damn well I don't want your religion in my science class. Just like I understand if I walk into a church, a mosque, a synagogue, or whatever, and start, you know, talking about stuff that made your God look bad from science, you'd be like, don't you believe this here. Cool, believe whatever you want. But in my science class, give me fucking science. Give me history that's history. Don't change it. By the way, random fact, not random fact, but, you know, let's remember that in the history books you guys probably read, the ones I read too, you know, if you had Black History Month and you were given the paragraph in the textbooks, that's what it was, the paragraph. Martin Luther King was the most hated man of his time. And he also was very ineffective. And I don't say that to discredit Dr. King. I say it because it's fucking true. He was shot in the head. Effective people don't get shot in the head for ending racism. All right? He worked because they didn't want people like Malcolm X coming up. They said, fuck that. Get Black people with him. Because he was the one that didn't fight back. Yeah. In reality, it took him 2 years to get a fucking bus to let people get on the goddamn bus and sit in the front. I mean, and again, this is also not me encouraging violence. It's me talking about American history. Ever since the Boston Tea Party, we've learned that nonviolent protest and non-looting doesn't work. That's why America started with the fucking Boston Tea Party, looting. Again, I'm not saying it's good, bad, or different. I'm just saying it's unfortunately, Colin Kaepernick took a knee. He was a son of a bitch. The NFL, you know, blacklisted him, whatever the fuck. And, you know, people aren't talking about police brutality. People go out and march quietly, you know, protest for Floyd. No one's talking about it. The second they started burning shit down, those cops went to jail. It was not before. And again, I wish it was not effective. I wish there were better ways to do it. But unfortunately, American history teaches us that is the only thing that works, because when people are polite and nice, you know, you need the carrot and the stick in America. And that's a goddamn shame, to be quite honest with you, because I want to believe in the America I was taught as a fourth grader, where Martin Luther King marched and people stopped being racist because of it. But then I grew up and said, oh, it's not true. In fact, I know I haven't talked about wrestling yet, but I'm,
that's okay.
30-second story. When I was 9 years old, me and my little brother were in a little playground in Boston, Massachusetts. We're visiting my dad's where he lived. And my dad was too tired to come with us, so let's go ahead. You guys can walk to the playground, it's a block away, high, watch your little brother. I go down there with my little brother, two cops come up, beat the shit out of some Black guy, you know, beat him to death. Like literally beating him with nightsticks. Cop looks at me and says, don't grow up, little nigger, I'll do this to you too. Racism's dead though, because Martin Luther King walked. I'm 9 years old, what the fuck did I do? I'm like, you know, and again, I'm not trying to say cops are all bad people, this is not what I'm saying. I'm saying the system is bad. Most cops are probably good people. I'm sorry, go ahead, Jeff.
That was 9 years ago. Or that was when you were
nine. No, I was nine.
That was when you were nine. So
I'm in my 40s now.
I didn't want to say your age, but I was
okay. I'm old. I get it. I'm fucking old.
And that happened then, and that was probably what in the 80s or 70s.
Yeah, that's the 80s.
80s. And what's crazy is that we, as a person, as a whole group, we haven't evolved. Technology has evolved. Technology is at the forefront. But as a group of people, as a human race, we haven't evolved.
Yeah.
Now, other people in other cultures have, but for some reason, we're slow.
I think the problem with America specifically is we're taught the lie that individualism is the greatest thing in the world. You know, you're taught, you know, be you because you're special and everything you think is special. And I'm not saying you're not special. What I'm saying is you're not more special than anyone else. And we're literally taught that, you know, just to care about ourselves, maybe your family too, but fuck everyone else. And I think it started with the mistake of letting capitalism grow to a point where it stopped becoming about, if I have a better product and provide better service, I can make more money than you, to the point where it's, fuck everyone else, I'm gonna destroy everyone else so I can make more money than everybody. And that's where I think that kind of mentality came from. Because again, I agree with that. If you have a better service and a better product, you should make more money. If you work harder, you should do better. I have no problem with that. But the idea that, I should crush you two so I can have a better podcast and I'll steal your listeners and whatever bullshit. I mean, hell, pro wrestling is a perfect example. You have independent companies, you know, literally fucking each other. You know, I've been accused of this, and I will say this on your podcast. I have never called the state on anyone. I have never fucking tried to get someone shut down. I get accused of it all the time. You know, I'm like, dude, I'm a fucking grown-ass man. I'm an elected official in my local town. I work for a charity that is doing great work with kids. I've got shit to do. It's like, I do wrestling as a very profitable side hustle. But it's like, I don't have time to fucking, you know, call the police on you or whatever just because I don't want your show to run. That's the mentality we're taught in America, is fuck everyone else, which is why we don't evolve.
Yeah, I work in the construction field, and that's more prevalent than it's ever been.
I'm sure people call and, you know, can we check the fucking license on that work site? Did they get the permit they need? You know, from other, get the fuck out of here. Let me do my job.
Not only that, but you'll see a lot of people trying to save a dollar by doing things cheaper, and where the product isn't what it should be, and you're charging the same amount as you would if you used a better product. And you see it all the time, all the time. I'm part of fixing those problems.
What was that town where the whole town was built? Like, I can't remember. There was some town where they built like all those McMansion type things. They built them with the shoddiest of materials, and a year and a half later, they were falling apart, and the whole town was suing the construction company that laid them down.
There's like, that in Philly.
Well, I know it happened in Philly too, but there was another town. It was a suburban town I'm thinking of. But you're right. It happens in Philly all the time.
It's happening right now. If you drive by any street in Philadelphia, you'll see construction, and you'll see how it's being erected. Yeah. And you'll say to yourself, how the fuck is that going to stand up for more than 20 years?
Plywood? Really? We're using plywood on houses? Like, only plywood?
Yeah, one layer of plywood. It's gotten
like, throw guys through plywood. It breaks easily, guys. It's not going to be a house.
And it goes to your point of where you have higher ups, people that make the code that are allowing this because it's going to be beneficial to the companies as a whole because they're going to be able to make more money. We're still making our money because we're making the fucking code. We can say whatever we want.
A lot of people making the code are the ones taking the donations from those companies that are making more money.
Absolutely.
I am vehemently opposed to money in politics as we have it now. I think it's ridiculous that people can donate in such obscene amounts because they are bribes. I mean, like, when I ran for office, I told people I want no more than a $5 donation from any one person. The company can give me up to 50. That's it. I don't want more because I don't want you to feel like I owe you anything. I'm a local guy. You know, I'm not a big fucking. I need signs, you know, to put on the lawns. That's all I was buying, basically. I don't need big commercials or any fucking shit. I was like, I need like $1,000. If you believe in me, give me $5. That's all I want. Because the problem with our system is people have to fundraise constantly because, you know, it's a popularity contest election because most Americans don't read, so we don't know people's real stances. So I have to have a flashy commercial, you know, saying, hi, I'm Tyrone Scott, and I promise I'm going to do this. I once worked as Maven Bentley in Combat Zone Wrestling, giving you entertainment, you know. But instead of actually just putting my platform somewhere where people would read it, or having a debate that's not about people's dick size, thank you for that, Donald Trump, people don't pay attention to real issues anymore. So, you know, I need the money so I can buy more commercial time, and I can get the attack ads on you and say that you're scary Al-Qaeda people. Even though, you know, your fucking thing was just, I want to change the zoning code to make sure that all materials are appropriate so the house doesn't fall down in 5 fucking years.
It's crazy because it's never truly the right person that ever gets the job. It's always the person that either knows someone or the person that has the most popularity, like you said, or someone who has the most money or someone who has all of it, then you know where it's going. I mean, it's And basically that would be the theme of this show, would be the system. The system's broken. The system needs to be fixed. And I mean, I'm leaning more towards your viewpoint of it's not going to get fixed. There's not anybody who's looking out for anybody else. It's everybody looking out for themselves. So you're not going to be able to truly fix the system when you can't get together as a group of people to try and fix it. You're letting other people do that.
Well, what's the incentive to fix it?
I mean, for the people in power, none. Because I think the people that are in power, and you said earlier, much earlier, the people that in power are, I forget the term that you use, but I think the people that are in power are partially scared. They're scared that they've been assholes for so long that if they were to give, say, the African-American people a fair shot or give them equal rights and equal opportunity, that they're going to turn around and fuck them. That's what they're scared of. They're going to turn around. We've been fucking killing you for so long that if we give you an inkling or a little bit, you're going to turn around and you're going to whack us because we've been fucking terrible for that long. That's what they're afraid of. They're afraid of if we lose power, we're done. We're dead.
I mean, you know, if you kick me 3 times and I get up, you're scared I'm going to kick you back. And I completely get it. And it's a shame. Again, it goes to this whole idea that I think we raise people to only care about themselves in this country. We raise people to think they're better than other people, as opposed to just understanding that we're all important in our own ways. And it doesn't hurt me to see you succeed. And I think that's where people people miss that. And again, even going back to pro wrestling, I've always been of the philosophy that, you know, although I think there are probably too many indies running in general, just because I don't think there's enough market share for it, it doesn't help my business to hurt your business. I'd rather try to make my business better by strengthening my business, and hopefully then I'll do more sales in whatever aspect I'm looking at, than, you know, trying to hurt you. Because calling the cops on your show, one, it's going to give you publicity. Because people, oh, shit, such and such company got shut down last night. Wow, what the fuck were they doing? It must have been awesome. Two, it's just, it's a waste of time and it's a waste of energy. I'd much rather say, what can I do to make my promotion better? What can I do to make my thing better versus hurting you? Because, you know, it's I don't know. It's silly to me.
I mean, David, I do want to ask that since you said about the different balance of power and stuff like that, and you are the president of CZW, as we said, coming into that position, was there any backlash or anything that you saw either from people that didn't think you should be in that position, or even people of your own race that thought, he's selling out now?
I mean, definitely not from people in my own race. I mean, I think the only problems I had in you know, of being like an authority figure was, you know, years ago in CZW when I was like first made the VP. And I was the big chair for Zandig. And for people that don't know John Zandig, in real life, towards the end of his career, John Zandig was very much a recluse in a way. He didn't talk to people. We didn't like people. He used to sit in the crow's nest and he wouldn't come down and talk to all the boys. And I'm not saying anything bad. I'm saying he just didn't want to deal with it. You know, he knew he was like, he's like, I'm, again, John's older than me. He's like, I'm old. I got things to do. I got kids at home. I don't want to sit here and have someone argue because they don't want to lose tonight. So he would send me down, and there were a couple people who thought that I was booking the show to make myself strong and make them look weak. And that was the only problem I had there. And I, for the record, I've never booked myself. And let me rephrase. The very few times I book myself, I always book myself to go under and look like shit. Like the first thing I ever got a chance to book was the angle with Blackout and the Hate Club. I booked me pee my pants. That was the part that I booked. I said to Nate Hatred, you're supposed to come grab me. If I piss myself, would that make you look stronger? He's like, that would be fucking hilarious. I was like, then I'll do it for you, dude. That was the first thing I ever booked in CZW, was me peeing my own pants when Nate Hatred grabbed me. But past that, I mean, there were people that didn't like seeing me in power, mostly because they were fucking assholes. Like the whiny boy, Joey Janela, who didn't like me too much. I'm not supposed to say that, and DJ High is going to call me and say, oh, God, you said his name. Now he's going to fucking start tweeting about us. You know, guy blamed me for losing a fake match where he didn't take the pin in a multi-man where we called on a favor from the WWE Cruiserweight Champion to come in and take the pin so he wouldn't have to. And he gets on the mic, "You screwed me, Maven Bentley. You made me lose on my last night like every wrestling traditionalist does. And you didn't make me take the pin, so you didn't even make me look weak, but I'm going to cry." By the way, and you know, I'm saving the full story for the shoot, but Joey Janela, you owe me your life. And you don't know that because people were waiting for you in the back with fucking baseball bats, and I stopped them. Hi, Joe. I'm sure I was here from his lawyer. Sorry.
All right. I don't want to.
Watch Best of the Best on CZWrestling.com.
I don't want to play too far away because I feel like that's an interesting subject in wrestling and basically in life in general, is that the generation coming in and the generation coming up and the ones that are working their way to the top, do you see more? Because I see it more as just a generational thing of the idea that everybody owes me something.
Yeah.
Everybody, I'm here and now you owe me something. I did this. I did this in a shorter time than you did, so now I'm owed something. And I'm not going to single out anybody, but just, I mean, you can, hey, by all means, you're our guest. You can do whatever the hell you want.
Exactly.
I don't want to single anyone out because I don't know them personally. You're the one in the back. I don't know them personally, but I feel like just watching just kids, not even wrestling related. Like I was just driving up to get my computer actually. And there was three kids in the road on bicycles on each side, swerving in and out of the lanes. And it's the like, I don't know, silver
entitlement.
Yeah. Entitlement that, okay, we can do this and we have no repercussions because our dad is so-and-so, we can do whatever the hell we want.
I think you're right. I think the biggest problem we have is, you know, the internet allows people to become stars too quickly and, or at least feel like they're stars. Right. So, yeah. You know, if I have 100 followers on my social media and I don't know 100 people in real life, I start feeling a fucking star. So I must be important and I'm self-entitled and whatever else. And for wrestlers specifically, because there are so many indies out and because so many of the guys, on the independent circuit, right, there are lots of indies and people just want exposure. So a lot of people, because this is what they want to do and they just want to feel that rush of the crowd, you know, they'll work cheap. And mind you, I'm not saying there's anything bad with working cheap. You can determine your own price. And sometimes, you know, like I tell people as a promoter, I have what I have to give you. And if it's not enough, I'm not offended if you don't take it, but that's all I got. So they get to work in front of these crowds and, you know, because 25 fucking people screamed your name in someone's gym one day, you fucking think you're a star and now, well, I'm a big man. No, you're not. And, you know, I always tell people, you know, if you've literally watched my career as a performer, I literally try to embarrass myself as much as possible to make someone else look good. Because I always say, when I walk away from pro wrestling, you know, I own property, I've got, you know, a good career, I've got, a very nice bank account. I was lucky enough that I've made some good investments and I have some good education. And I did well. So I don't need wrestling to boost my ego. I really don't. So I'd much rather use it to boost some of these young kids up. I want to say hi to Drew Blood because Drew Blood's a good dude. And I remember there was a thing me and him did in the ring. Drew Blood is much shorter than me. I remember Salamander Jones, who was a commentator, came to me after the show and shook my hand. He's like, dude, that was the best cowering I've ever seen. The guy is literally 2 feet shorter than you. And you hunched so much that people thought you were the same height. And then you cowered to him. He's like, you whip his ass in real life. And he's like, that was so cool. I'm like, that's my job. That's what I want to do. I don't feel entitled that I need to be the star of the show. But you're definitely right. Kids come out and they think, I should be getting more. Or how come I get in line for a title shot or, you know, whatever else? I'm like, it's a fucking fake sport. First of all, you don't know shit from shit. Second of all, it's a fucking fake sport. And if you want to see guys who really respected this business, look at guys like a Mick Foley. Mick Foley lost every match you remember from Mick Foley, except the one where Steve Austin helped him win the championship, right? Like, Hell in a Cell, he lost. You know, him and Vader, he lost. You know, Foley lay on his back more than a fucking prostitute. And he's still one of the most, you know, loved guys in the business because Foley knew how to stay over. And he also worked his way through the system. He worked I think it's another problem. We don't have territories anymore. So it used to be you had to work your way through the territories, the old school gyms, and I think at the CZW Academy will tell you, you know, the newer ones have never seen Maven. I used to help train at the Academy. And I come in every now and then and fill in if DJ's overseas or something, or Joe Gacy's not around or whatever. And, you know, I do what they call Maven drills. And the kids look at me like I'm crazy. In fact, the rep will tell you, they were like, our second day of training, our first day was a tryout, the second day they gave you to us. And he's like, and I look at him saying, okay, you guys want to be wrestlers? 500 squats. And they're like, what is it? 500 squats. We'll warm up with that, and then I'll see if you guys are ready to come in the ring with me. And they were like, what the fuck? I was like, So the official Maven start is what we call 5-500s. 500 squats, 500 jumping jacks, 500 burpees, 500 push-ups, 500 sit-ups. After that, then we'll talk about wrestling.
You lost me at burpees.
Yeah.
I lose most people at burpees. Mm-hmm. And then you have to do Maven circuit drills, which, and I appreciate this. Joe Gacy once said to me, this is the reason why I lost all that weight. Because I literally just put all the guys around the ring or gals around, and we do different exercises for whoever's on the outside. When they've done 60 squats, we switch. And we'll do them for hours. Like, cause I'm also a believer of, if you're going to pretend to be a pro athlete, at least look like you work out. And I'm not saying you have to be jacked up, because, you know, there are a lot of men and women who are in this business that aren't jacked up people. But if you don't look, you've ever been to a gym, why would I pay money to see you in a pro fight? And that's just ridiculous.
Or at least be able to move like Boss Man or Vader.
Well, Boss Man, you can be big and still look like you're athletic. Like, you know what I mean? You're right. Boss Man can move. Vader, I think I would not fight Van Vader. If Vader was still here and he said, fuck you. Sorry, man. My bad. Because Vader, like, he could fuck you up. You could still have a belly. You could still be, you know, heavier. But even Boss Man, he looked like he knew where Jim was. He was a thick guy. Yeah, he had a belly. He likes to eat and drink. Nothing wrong with that. But, yeah, some of these kids – you know, you come in looking at your 112 pounds, you know, unless that's your gimmick, like a guy like Cheeseburger has made a career off of it. And Cheeseburger can actually go. But some of these kids come in with no body.
Huh? With the best of them.
Yeah. And you know, so a guy like him I respect. Not everyone's going to be fucking, you know, John Cena built. But guys like Cheeseburger are one in a million because he is physically tough. He's a very good performer. He can do all the stuff you need him to do, and he also knows how to use his size to his advantage. You know, but you can't have 25 cheeseburgers on a show. One, because there's only one, and two, if everyone looked like that, you'd be like, is this really, you know, unless you have like some kind of a weight division, like an MMA type thing. And even if you look at the MMA, so Wilson Hayes was one of my coaches in jiu-jitsu. He's a flyweight in UFC. Mm-hmm. Wilson Hayes, he fights at 125 pounds. He walks around 160. Even at 125, he looks like he will fuck you up. He's just short. But you can tell the man hits the gym. To me, it's offensive, but you're right. These young people, and I'm not saying all young people, but they're definitely people who feel entitled because they have a YouTube video and it got 100 views and, oh, fuck, I must be a star now. Or, you know, I'm at a weekly wrestling show with someone, you know, and ooh, look at me. The same people come and see me every week. That's cool, but you're not a star. And I try to impart this on the young kids that I do work with, that real life is first, because the likelihood of you making any money in the wrestling business, anyone watching this that wants to be a pro wrestler, the likelihood that you will make it and make good money in the wrestling business is very, 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 very slim. Less than the NFL, less than the NBA, less than all other major sports, because there's 1.5 leagues where you can make money in America, right? AEW is around for now. We don't know if they'll stick around, and that's not me bashing them. It's just me saying they're new. You don't know if they're going to last or not. WWE is the only other place, and they only keep so many people on roster. Other than that, you better hope you can make it to Japan, because there just isn't big money in wrestling. Now, you can make money on the indies. You know, if you become a David Starr, for example. Starr makes his living exclusively wrestling. But he's the exception to the rule because he's that good. But most people, you know, I mean, indie paydays are not big money, you know. I've taken paydays, specifically talking about the rep, right? I love those guys. I mean, really, Nate and Dave and Bishop has become this too, are like brothers to me, like little brothers. I mean, you know, there's an unreleased promo that I actually didn't put up on, we filmed it for CZW the day my daughter was born. And I didn't put it up because my wife at the time, that's now my ex-wife, you know, had reservations. My daughter, she was born and she almost died after birth. And I, you know, they wouldn't let me see her. Like she was rushed out. You can't see her till tomorrow. We've got to, you know. And it was the night of the CZW show. I went to the show because I was going crazy. because my wife was like knocked out. She, you know, they knocked her out, so she couldn't be up. And I was like, I'm going to literally just go crazy. And I went to the show and I asked Nate, Dave, and Bishop, could I do a promo just to get something off my chest? And I told the truth. You know, the first call when I got to the hospital was Dave McCall from the rep. Yo, man, I hope everything's good, man. Whatever you need, we got your back. Don't worry about the shows, man. You do that thing, get your baby here, and we got you. Nate sent me a Facebook message right after. Bishop actually went to my house, because I was campaigning at the time for my election, and took all the yard signs and said, I will start putting these out tomorrow. Don't you worry about it. I got your back. And, you know, so like I said, there are people in the business who really have respect and are great people, but there are also these entitled little pricks who think they're, you know, I can do a drop kick, so I need to be a world champion. You know, I mean, I'm not going to call this guy a prick, but I will say sometimes people are given too much or expect too much, and then they find out in the ring from an old school guy that they got too much too quickly, and they're stretched out. And, you know, it's unfortunate, but even to the point you made, Joe, about kids on the highway, you know, there was a time where cars went, fuck you, kid, move.
Yeah, and that's how I grew up. That's
right. I'm not saying that's good or bad. I'm just saying there's a difference. And we learned how to stay in our lane, literally, sometimes.
Yeah.
When I rode my bike and cars came by, I swerved to the side because I don't want the fucking car hitting me. You know, young kid wrestlers, sometimes when the vet comes in, you're supposed to, you know, I'm not saying you got to, you know, I'm old school, you got to come carry my bags and all that bullshit. But listen, pay respect, you know, learn why. There's no, and I tell these kids this all the time, I make more of most shows I'm in than every wrestler in the ring. And that's not me bragging. Maven Bentley's the best. It's because Maven figured out the system. Maven, I work backstage more than I work in front of the camera because that's where the money is. And, you know, you have to understand it. So if you want to, like I said, there's no retirement plan. Most people won't make money. If you want to be a pro wrestler, learn something else. Learn how to be a production guy too. Learn how to be a promoter. Learn how to do a licensing and bonding that I do. Learn the other stuff, because you'll get your bookings, but unless you're lucky enough to be someone signed by one of those major organizations, or lucky enough to be someone like a David Starr who travels the Indies, you're probably going to be, you know, a weekend warrior who makes a little bit of money on the weekend, destroys their body, and, you know, doesn't realize it's their my age, that, oh, fuck, I shouldn't have done that for 20 years, and now my knees don't work, and all I made was $75 a fucking night. You know, this is wrestling.
All right, I wanted to keep it wrestling related, and since you are a black man who is higher up in a wrestling company, there really isn't, I mean, there's more now, but the African-American population in wrestling alone is very scarce, especially, I mean, that goes for any company. That goes from WWE all the way down to whoever you would consider the lowest company. And do you feel like that, if more people like yourself were in power, that they would get their opportunity? Or do you think that, well, obviously I think that would be the case, but do you think that needs to happen? Do you think more African-American males or females in wrestling need to become behind the scenes more higher up for the other African-Americans to get their dues?
I think you need representation in any field, right? So if America is 13% African-American and, you know, 57% Caucasian and whatever the stats are, right, then excuse me, any company that doesn't at least represent that misrepresents America. So if all the top brass at a company are Caucasian, then they're going to do what they're familiar with. And there may be things about the African-American culture that they're not familiar with, or things that don't make them feel comfortable. You know, I think of, you know, I way back in the day, I did some model scouting with the group. And, you know, like the code for a white girl with big boobs and blonde hair was all American. You know, like, find an all American girl for us. And I'm like, well, there are black people in America, there are Asian people in America. What makes blonde hair, big boobs, all American? So when you talk about that behind the scenes, that's part of it. I mean, I think the other problem too is that you have blatant racists at the top of a lot of promotions. I mean, that's not a secret. And what's even worse about it is that sometimes some of the young people that make their living just wrestling, they're forced to work for them. You know, I know that I've had conversations with young black wrestlers who would call me and say, dude, I know so-and-so called you a nigger to your face, and, you know, I swore I'd never work for them, but my fucking baby needs to eat. And they just call me and double my price. I'm like, I'm never going to tell someone that they should make money to feed their child. But it's like, you know, imagine the indignity of that. You know, if I spat on your mom and then you had to work for me because otherwise your kid doesn't eat, how would you feel?
You got my...
That's what's happening in wrestling. I mean, there are numerous promoters. You know, I mean, I've been fortunate that, you know, I'm in a position where I don't have to deal with all of them. I can kind of pick and choose where I go. But I mean, you know, there have been plenty of times where, you know, you know, things have almost broken out in locker rooms because, you know, I don't tolerate that kind of stuff. And I'm a pretty nonviolent guy. But, you know, I mean, there's only two people in wrestling I almost had a shoot fight with. And one of them is because he said, you know, fuck you, nigger, and I hope your mom dies. And my mom was dying at the time. I remember I jumped up and I fell over because I destroyed my knee playing MMA the night before. And I think it was Devin Moore and Nui Tufinga who kind of grabbed me and calmed me down. And we had the police remove the guy because they're like, dude, don't go to jail for this asshole. You got to go see your mom in the hospital tomorrow. Don't do that. My mom actually died the next day. So this guy ever get a pass from Maven Bentley. No matter how much people ask, how come you don't do business with so-and-so? Fuck him. I hope he dies. I'm talking about Brett Lard of GCW, by the way. Hi, Brett. Sue me. You did it. You got witnesses.
So, I mean, people being in power and having the ability to basically decide the fate of certain people. I mean, how do we get to a point of where that's not the case? I mean, that's like the million-dollar question for not just wrestling, for life.
I mean, we don't. I mean, that's the honest truth of it. I mean, unless you happen to have money and can start your own company. Tony Khan's as close as you're getting right now, right?
Yeah.
He's a fucking millionaire, so he can do what he wants. And, you know, I don't know. I mean, I have friends in AEW, but I haven't done business with them. My understanding is they try to be very, what word am I looking for? They try to be inclusive and such. I don't know if it's just taglines they put out on the internet or they really mean it, because I don't work for them. But, you know, the biggest place where you can really go to learn the craft of wrestling and become a star, you know, it's riddled with racism. It's, you know, I mean, I don't want to get any of my friends in trouble, so I'm not going to name people that I'm friends with that work certain places. But let me ask you a question.
Sure.
What are you saying about the black community when you push a team called Crime Time? What are you saying about the black community when, you know, every African-American performer you have, you know, until about 2005 has to be a jive-talking, either dancing or criminal type of guy?
And then you have a full faction of African-Americans that are booked to lose except for one.
Yeah. I mean, and mind you, the winning and losing doesn't even bother me, to be honest, because it's a fake sport. I don't care, you know, like, you know, if you've ever heard the story about Haku is probably the toughest man that ever has been in a pro wrestling ring. Haku lost all the time in WWF, right? But Haku could literally rip your fucking teeth out of your mouth and, you know, laugh about it afterwards. Also, literally the nicest guy you'll ever meet. Wonderful dude. But so the winning and losing doesn't bother me. What bothers me more is just that, you know, you're being betrayed a certain way and you're being degraded. And sometimes if you step up and ask for a less offensive role, then you're seen as difficult. You know, or if you do something that everyone else does. I mean, you know, there was a situation that was documented that Titus O'Neil, you know, stopped Vince McMahon and said, let the lady go first when Stephanie was trying to walk. And he got suspended for 90 days. Or it was 60 because Batista stepped in and said, dude, really?
Yeah.
Because Titus is the nicest guy. I mean, I was just telling Larry before we went on the air, I was doing some emailing with him because he's doing some charity work with me. And, you know, nicest dude ever. And
that shows. That shows fully. Anytime he's portrayed as anything on TV, he's always, always putting others first.
Yeah, he. I mean, that's him. I mean, I'm not gonna say that I'm his best friend. I know everything about him, but I'm saying every interaction I've ever had with him has been pleasant. And like, you know, I remember one time I literally called him about a speech he was supposed to give for some teachers with me. He said, "Let me give you a call back." I'm like, okay. He called me back and said, oh, man, I'm sorry. I was just at the dentist. You know, I've been buying all these kid braces in the community. It's like thousands of kids that he helped get braces. They couldn't afford them. And I'm like, you are the nicest human being ever. And the fact that you because wrestling is full of jokes and ribs and stuff like that. That's what all the boys do with each other. The fact that you, and that's not even like a mean rib. It's like, hey, man, let the lady go first. That's worth being suspended for? Where you got, you know, other people literally hurting people in the ring on purpose, guys stuff in there, you know, like, you know, you think of how the Attitude Era began with Shawn Michaels doing sexual stuff on TV on a kid's show, because it was a kid's show then. Shawn didn't get suspended. Shawn got a small fine and then, you know, got pushed to the world title. You know, I mean, it's obvious when you really think about it, and I'm sure there'll be people say, oh, no, there's no racism, and that helped you treat me really well. And you might have been treated well. But it was a matter of the fact that you could make profit for them there, not the fact that they respected you as a human being. And to be honest, my opinion of most promoters is they don't treat the wrestlers like human beings, period. Whether you're talking big leagues or little leagues, they're looking at them as ways to make money. And, you know, I pride myself that I try as a promoter to take the human route. And even in a company like CZW where, you know, people, oh, it's fucking crazy. You're fucking hitting each other with weed whackers and shit. You know, I, to my knowledge, and the only person who's ever been in the big seat in CZW that vetoed certain things just because of safety concerns. And no, John Zandig did too. I'm sorry, John Zandig did once too. He vetoed the pencil thing that Man Pondo took in Tournament Death 4, I think it was. And Pondo said, ah, fuck you, I'm doing it anyway. And had pencils up his ass and little Mondo had to pick out for an hour. you know, I do think about the safety of the boys and girls that go in again our ring. I think of them as human beings first. Again, I'm not perfect. I'm not going to sit here and say, I don't book for money when I book, because I do want, you know, to make a profit. That's the idea of the company. But, you know, so many people, to your original question, well, more African, how do we get more African-Americans in places? I don't know. You know, the biggest company in the world has, you know, a guy who doesn't really care for African-Americans in the top. So I don't know. Indies don't have any money. You know, I can't hire an assistant to work under me and learn stuff. You know, I take the young kids who come to CZW and want to learn, and regardless of race, you know, work with them. And I will admit that obviously the African-American wrestlers and some Latino wrestlers gravitated to me more than probably some of the white ones. Because they're looking at a guy who, you know, a black man who, you know, has been successful in life, and they just want to know how to be successful in general. And I always tell them, this is, you know, it's not even wrestling. I'll teach you how to be successful, or at least what worked for me to be successful, period. Because wrestling is just one thing I do. And I enjoy it. I think that I'm good at it. I'm very blessed that, you know, some of the major companies call me when they come to Philadelphia because they want me to be backstage and help things out. But, you know, it's much deeper than pro wrestling, because once I'm done with wrestling, which I will be relatively soon, I'm getting old. I gotta have something else, you know?
Yeah. Well, you always gotta have that fallback. I mean, this is America. You have to have money until you're 90.
Yeah. Yeah, our healthcare system sucks, and if you get sick, you're dying. You get a GoFundMe.
Yeah.
Yeah. Sometimes it's controversial.
Sometimes that's not even legitimate.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I know. America's one of the weirdest countries in the world because, you know, we can't agree on human decency. We can't agree that people shouldn't die because they're poor. We can't agree people shouldn't die because of a skin color. We can't agree on something. I've got 5-year-old kids I do charity work with who know better than the adults. It's very, very sad to me. Mm-hmm.
Because they haven't had it drilled into their brain for years and years.
Yeah.
And years.
Yes.
Right.
That's where that's where it all starts, is with the youth. Yeah. With this generation, is as little of people or as no people as possible that we need filling their heads with hate. I mean, yeah. How else are you gonna fix anything? It literally is. When they send children on the future, yes, that's exactly what it is. So why are we teaching them? Why are we teaching them things that are going to set us back hundreds of years?
Because it's helpful to the people teaching them that stuff. You know, I mean, again, the racism is a power structure. It's not about hate for black people or Asian people or Latino people. It's about, it keeps me in power. Because if I can convince two white guys that they're better than the black guy, then I can control those two white guys. He's not getting better than the black guy. And also, you know, you're not looking at what I'm doing to you. You know, it's the, you know, the internet meme where, you know, there are 10 cookies on the table, the rich guy has 9 of them, and then tells the other guy with one, hey, that black guy's trying to steal your cookie. You know, it's a power structure. It works too, because people are scared. We're naturally, inherently scared of things, and we like things to fear and things to blame. So it's always easier to say, you know, the other is the reason why I don't have or whatever than it is to say, What can I do to better myself? What can I do that doesn't hurt someone to better myself? It is easier to hurt somebody than it is to improve yourself.
I also think that when I've heard numerous times when I was younger and whatnot, I think this is a trait that is probably handed down, that when you see something, keep your mouth shut because you don't want to get in trouble too. I think that was something big, that when you see something when you're little, shh, don't say anything. You don't want to get in trouble too.
Yeah.
I think that carries to when you're adult and you see something happening. Well, if I step in, I'm going to face some sort of repercussion. I don't know what that might be. Depending on the repercussion, it could be jail. It could be, I'm going to get hurt. And that's just another way to keep people scared, that the people that are teaching you, don't step in. Even if you know it's wrong, you don't want to hurt yourself.
You're absolutely right. And, you know, it's a slightly different example, but it goes to right with what you said. I'm a big 90s, 80s and 90s rap guy. You know, and Chuck D from Public Enemy, you know, they did a song called See Something, Say Something. And he once explained, he's like, you know, the term snitch, if people think you're snitching on somebody, that was not a term that people doing bad, you know, when you were snitching in the 70s or 60s, is because you were telling when African-American leaders doing the right thing. And you snitched, you know, like when the Black Panther Party was setting up free lunch programs for kids, or free breakfast rather for kids, you go to the police, that's where they're going to be, go break it up, you know. And that mentality became, you know, don't ever tell somebody because they're going to come back for you, you know, stitches or whatever, and you might go to jail, you might do whatever. You know, I always say, you know, I applaud real people who are doing right, telling people doing wrong, or telling people to stop doing wrong. I applaud them. The simple philosophy I always use is, imagine whatever was happening, the bad thing was happening to your grandmother. Would you want someone else stopping it? You know, if you're watching somebody, you know, beat somebody up in the street, would you want someone to stop it if that was your grandmother getting beat up? If you want someone giving you racial slurs to you, you know, if that was your grandmother, would you want them to stop? And if you just turn your head and don't pay attention, and, you know, why should someone help your grandmother? You know, even if it's not you, because some people are like, I don't care about me. But most people, you know, care about their, you know, the elders in their family. And if it's, you know, well, that's the way I see this, is if I see something bad, I say something. And I speak up. And, you know, I mean, I've become more vocal in wrestling in the last year or so because, you know, I mentioned two names. Bad. I would never do that because I never wanted to get CZW heat. These are the thoughts of Maven, not the thoughts of CZW. But I'm at the point where I'm like, well, you know, people should know the truth about stuff. And I'm a big boy, you know, and you know, again, I'll retire from wrestling soon and I'll still have $1 million in the bank and I'll still fucking have a great charitable career and I'll still fucking, you know, hopefully be helping children as I've been doing for the last couple of years, and, you know, working with my nonprofit and, you know, being on school boards places. It's like, I don't give a fuck. If you know, so-and-so wants to tweet now that I'm an asshole, or I never made it through, that's why you're not in AEW like me. Okay. I own $500,000 home. I got two cars that are more than your mom's attic that you live in. I'm okay not being in AEW. I don't want to, you know, no. I like Cody. It's not a slash of AEW, but. AEW.
So not sorry,
Cody. I like your company, Cody. I'm not cheating on your company.
Not only our fans
today.
Not only are the fans fickle, but you're saying wrestlers can be fickle as well?
Wrestlers are the biggest prima donna babies on earth. And this is true. I mean, it's funny because
Hogan.
Yeah, Hogan. Hogan's a great example. You know, and mind you, not all of them, because like anything else, it's not everybody. But, yeah. you know, I can't remember who said this to me, and I'm so sorry if whoever sees this. You know, I said that, motherfucker. I would give you credit if I remember who said it, but I get hit in the head a lot. Somebody told me, if you were really that tough, why wouldn't you be fighting MMA right now? You're not a tough guy. You're a crybaby crying over a fake title that someone gave you. You didn't win it. No, I won the world. No, you didn't. I fucking underlined your name. You didn't win shit. You know, I mean, like I said, I fought pro fights. I've won some, I've lost some. You know, the ones I won, I won. The ones I lost, I lost. You know, but once because someone underlined my name, well, get the fuck out of here. They're fickle, they're babies. And again, and I'm sure some people will start calling DJ, I don't want to work with Maven anymore. If you're a baby, that's what you say. If you're not a baby, you say, yep. As those assholes in the locker room that politicked out of losing, because why should I lose? It's a fucking work. It's not real. I pay you the same amount of money whether you win or lose. You know, I mean, unless I'm telling you to fucking, you know, I'm going to have a fucking 95-year-old grandma pin you with one punch. And even then, I still should fucking do it because I'm paying you. Why do you care? It's not real. If you were tough, you'd be in MMA. Matt Riddle's like the only guy that can talk shit, right?
Everyone feels like everyone's not an individual anymore. Everyone is a brand.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And anytime that something negative happens, it hurts their brand.
See, this is the problem. If you Coca-Cola, the greatest branding scheme of all time is New Coke. I don't know if you gentlemen are old enough to remember New Coke.
We are.
All right, good. So that shit was – there was uprising. Bring back the original recipe. That loss made them more money than any win they ever had. They took – you can't convince me that that wasn't like pro wrestling so that they worked it. We're going to lose so we can do the comeback like Hogan. This is the – you bring back the New Coke. You know, bring back the old Coke. So, I mean – it's not fucking real. I don't understand how people, you know, I mean, I've had people really get mad at me. You know, I'm losing tonight. Who gives a flying fuck? I'm paying you, right? It's not real. If you're that tough, the greatest answer I learned from this, again, I credit John Zandig with a lot of learning in the wrestling business. Because I learned under him, I learned off of the Wild Samoan. And although off is a lot calmer in these days, in these younger days, he was more like Zandig. You know, John would be like, got a problem? Your pay's in my pocket. Come get it. And that would be the end of it. It's like, you know, I want to look. And I remember guys just, man, fuck you. I'm not losing. I'm not laying down. I'm not getting that guy. I'm not, blah, 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 blah. Go talk to John. I'm like, okay, fine. You don't have to do shit. You want to get paid? Your money's in my pocket. Come get it. I dare you. I'm sorry. Maybe what I meant to say was the roll up instead of the back of the Paul Punch offer, please. You know, don't. If you're a wrestler, it's a job. If you go to McDonald's until you get on fries and you want to be on the fucking hamburger fryer, you fucking get on fries. You know? That's it. If I'm not endangering you, and I do think the guys and girls should step up. If somebody says, I want you to fucking take a wee whacker to the fucking eyeball and jump off a building, and you're like, I can't do that safely, that's when you say no. But if I tell you to lay down for another professional who's taking care of your body in the ring, and you say no, then you're a fucking pussy. Get the fuck out of the business.
Look. You know? I don't know if there's a better way of ending that show than that line right there. So Maven, thank you so much for taking the time and doing this. It's an honor. We really appreciate you taking the time and doing it for us.
No problem, gentlemen. I wish you guys luck. I hope your podcast picks up a lot of steam. I'm happy to be the second guest. You know, I'm not going to mention you didn't pick me first, but whatever. But seriously, guys, good luck to you. And thank you for having me.
All right, thanks a lot.